Philippine Economic Zone Authority Director General, Mr. Teres Opanga. He joins us live from Las Vegas. Good morning to you, sir, and welcome to Market Edge.
Hi, good morning, Stanley, and to all your viewers.
All right. Now, PEZA is up for more investment opportunities in 2024 through multiplying eco-zones in the country. Now, talk about strategic focus and an aggressive approach to acquiring investments alongside the ASEAN and other global partners, of course, which you're doing right now. Describe to us, Mr. Panga, what this roadmap is all about.
Well, the roadmap is how PEZA can be more aggressive in promoting the Philippines to global investors and taking the cue from the president, as he is the most active in promoting the Philippines through investment promotions, through his travels abroad. PEZA is doing the same thing by doing a follow-through. Right now, we are in Las Vegas, in the U.S., to participate in the Consumer Electronics Forum exhibit. This is the biggest electronics event in the U.S., participated by many emerging tech providers, latest innovators and technology providers. And this is where we want to attract foreign investors to invest in the Philippines by making our presence felt in such kind of international forum.
Okay, and are there specific industries that you are trying to push? Because, you know, we've been looking at the export numbers recently and there has been a slump, and a large chunk of that slump has been attributed to low production of semiconductors. Now, how does that fit into your picture, and what kind of enhancements or improvements are you expecting as a result of those investment roadshows?
Well, we continue to... Well, yes, we are aware of the flat growth being projected by the semicon industry in the Philippines. I think that's the global industry situation. But we are preparing for the upturn in 2025. So part of our preparations is to aggressively reach out to EMS, SMS, electronics companies, not just in the U.S., but even in Japan and other sources of FDI. And in this particular mission, we're actually eyeing advanced manufacturing as well as EV and mostly AI-driven investments, which have huge potentials in the Philippines for manufacturing.
Okay, Director General Pang, looking at investment approvals, though, we are seeing some positive numbers. I think we have the numbers that we can show on the screen right now, steadily growing since 2022 at 140 billion, 2023 at 175, and for 2024, the target is 250 billion. Now, quite an ambitious jump there. What conditions do you factor in to aim for this kind of goal this year?
Well, for this year, we're eyeing actually a 200 to 250 billion in investments coming from a high investment approvals last year. In 2022, when President Marcos assumed into office, that was when we actually realized bigger investments. 81% of our 140 billion in investments came in during the time of President Marcos. And last year, we were able to achieve a 25% increase while we were only eyeing a 10% target. So we are eyeing to sustain this growth momentum. And if we're able to hit 250 billion investments, that will bring us back to the time when PEZA had the highest levels of investments in 2012 to 2015.
All right. Also, PEZA's target sectors this year, quite a list here, very robust. It includes electric vehicles, of course. You have renewable energy and alternative energy and even regenerative agriculture. Which of these now are you seeing as the most or having the most potential for the Philippines in terms of contributing to trade and even exports? Because we're looking at the latest World Bank outlook. It is saying it's still gloomy, although it's not unique to the Philippines. It's a global trend. Weak demand is still persisting for 2024, and anything that could up the export numbers in the Philippines and also improve our trade is totally welcome. So which of these target sectors do you see more potential now?
Well, we've been trying to diversify our export products and investments. So while we anticipate a flat growth in electronics, we're looking at EEV as a strong potential for investments as well as exports, including agriculture. And of course, the bullish growth of the IT industry, still eyeing a 10 to 15% growth. And so we will be more aggressive in promoting the Philippines to global investors.
Okay, and speaking of global investors, also we need to expand our existing partner countries to foster, of course, new trade and investments. Now, which countries are we exploring partnerships with aside from the U.S. and Japan?
Well, we're looking at the non-traditional sources of investments and exports. Our accession into RCEP, because of that, we're looking at partnering with the chambers in Australia. We're also looking at Taiwan and, of course, Canada with the upcoming FTA. And the new FTA to be signed with South Korea could trigger also investments coming from South Korea. And so we work closely not just with the embassies abroad, but also with the foreign chambers in the Philippines representing these countries.
Okay.
And as well as with our PTICs stationed overseas.
And from your perspective as well, when you talk about growth, we're talking about expansion or even adding more economic zones in the Philippines. How many do we have so far? And how many more are you trying to establish in the horizon?
Well, currently we have 422 operating economic zones. So these are new types. These are various types of economic zones. But we're looking at venturing into new types of economic zones, the likes of KIST parks. You have the renewable energy parks. And so we hope that the proclamation process will lead to declaration of more eco zones at 30 at least yearly. Mm-hmm. So that we can spread the creation of eco zones nationwide and in the process accelerate our countrywide development.
And are all of our economic zones successful in that sense, sir?
Well, from our viewpoint, we only call it operational or operating economic zones. These eco zones are actually hosting locator companies. And so we can say that with the presence of these companies, either manufacturing or doing IT services in these economic zones, that's enough to say that we are successful in terms of generating jobs, exports, and other economic opportunities for the country, particularly those in rural and new growth areas.
All right. Of course, you're in the U.S. now, but we're also setting sights on Japan. The president has, in fact, visited Japan for trade missions, also linkages, and some collaboration with Japanese investors. Now, what are the results, the direct results of these foreign trips there?
Well, because of that, Japanese continues to be our number one investor through thick and thin and for the long haul. In fact, they constitute 27% of our total investments. Last year in 2022, we were able to register as much as 17.7 billion pesos in investments from Japanese equity investments alone. And in 2023, we were able to increase it to 194% at 52.2 billion pesos. And so we cannot discount really the huge contributions of Japanese investors. And so we will continue to be more aggressive with our, particularly with our outbound investment missions to Japan.
Okay, 194%, that's quite a jump, and we expect that to be enhanced by more accommodations, more arrangements with Japan as an economic partner of the Philippines. Of course, you have the upcoming signing of a memorandum of agreement between PESA, Rizal Banking, Commercial Banking Corporation, and Sumitomo Mitsui Banking Corporation. These have been identified as partners to foster investments from Japan. First, tell us about this partnership and when is it going to be launched?
Well, as soon as we go back to the Philippines, we're slated to sign our MOU with the Sumitomo Bank as well as RCBC being their local partner. Sumitomo Bank being the largest bank in Japan and one of the largest banks in the world. And RCBC happens to be the biggest bank provider with its presence in most of our, especially in our manufacturing economic zones. And part of our collaboration is that they will assist us in promoting the Philippines to Japanese investors with our inbound, outbound delegations of investors and also through networking with the bank's valued clients and the Japanese chambers. And other than the usual generation of FDI leads and the follow-through with Japanese would-be investors, this collaboration is meant also to promote access to financial services, which the banks can offer to support the operations and expansions of our existing Japanese locator companies.
All right, you have these collaborations now with banks. How big a market are you looking at for Japan, for the Philippines in the future?
Well, as I mentioned, it's 52.2 billion pesos in 2023. So easily, if we add up another 20% to that, so we're eyeing also some 70 to 80 billion pesos in investments that we're targeting from the Japanese market alone. And there's a huge potential from the Japanese SMEs. They account for the biggest sector in Japan economy, and in order for us to support their going global when it comes to scaling up operations, we're opening the Philippines to be their hub, not just to supply to the local market or to also to support their export commitments as well.
All right, Director General Panga, of course, going back to the CES, the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas, what else do we look forward to as the event unfolds?
Well, right now we're in talks with serious leads. Some have already committed to visiting the Philippines, and you'll be amazed by the kind of technology that they're into. And we say that we have in the PEZA, in the Philippines, in the economic zones, we can provide for the best location and ecosystem to support their operations, especially with our huge talent pool. And so we're really looking at emerging technologies, the latest innovations, because that's one way we can go up the value chain by engaging in high-tech products. And in the process, we can also integrate the local SMEs to be part of the Ecozone value chain. And for this to be exporters themselves when they locate in the PEZA zones to initially support the operations of these companies and eventually going export markets.
Of course, these discussions is not just center on the strengths or prospects for the Philippines, but the challenges as well. I was wondering, what challenges did many of these investors or potential partners bring up for the Philippines to scale up as well in terms of capacity building and even upskilling of workers to prepare for these future collaborations?
Well, they cited about the readiness of our workers to support especially their operations, which are really into high tech. And so we explained to them that there's a huge turnout of college graduates. We have we are the youngest in terms of labor workforce.
Okay.
And so what it needs really is how we can train all these workers through our collaborations with the universities, with the tech box, with TESDA, so that we can narrow the gaps between available skills and the needed skills by the industries. Mm-hmm. And towards this end, the industry with the likes of the Electronics Industry Association of the Philippines, we're also working closely with the UP, with the DOLE, on how we can narrow these gaps and how we can align the curriculum and the VOCTECs so that we can have these special training courses that are aligned with the needs of the industries. And in this case, with the USAID, we recently had this project on preparing the workforce for advanced manufacturing.
All right. Lastly, Director General Panga, for better economic recovery in 2024. Now, the country needs more foreign investments, whether it's putting up businesses here or partnering with hard projects such as infrastructure. What is PEZA doing differently in 2024 to be able to achieve this?
Well, in PEZA, we continue to strengthen our mandate, which is really to attract investments into the country so that we can generate jobs, exports, and other economic opportunities for the country. And so we're enhancing our further enhancing our ease of doing business, because we see that direct correlation in terms of attracting FDI. And on the infrastructure side, we have the economic zones to support the operations of these global investors. Mm-hmm. And if we're able to complete the supply chain so that other than the Ecozones, we can mobilize all the resources, the support group coming from government in the industries, I think we can be competitive when it comes to attracting FDI and growing our export sector.
All right, on that note, Director General Teres Opang of the Philippine Economic Zones Authority, again, thank you for joining us this morning. Have a great day.